Hello, my friends. Hello, and welcome once again to the adventurous Vaughn Manor, where Roger and I are taking an adventure back in time for Bookshelf Essentials. Bookshelf Essentials, which is a video series created by the great David Wiley over on his channel, where he'll talk about certain books that are essential to his personal library, books that he would never get rid of for any reason whatsoever. And a few of us other booktubers have decided to do our own Bookshelf Essentials. And the books I'm talking about today, I'm talking about a series of books, every single volume of which is absolutely essential to my library. Today, I'm talking about the landmark series of ancient histories. This series of books was created by Robert B. Strassler. Robert B. Strassler. There he is there when he was a younger Robert B. Strassler. Robert B. Strassler, an independent scholar. He's independent. Like me and Roger, we're independent scholars too. Yeah, so he's an independent scholar who became very interested in ancient history and the ancient historians. But the editions that he would find ancient histories in, he found completely unsatisfying and not good enough. Because even though ancient history volumes from Penguin or Oxford or whatever, this is the first volume from the landmark editions that came out. This is the landmark Thucydides. The Thucydides edition from Penguin, you know, the translation was good enough, but what you really need for something like this are maps and a bunch of footnotes and a bunch of other information that you might not have as an individual living in the 21st century. Because we're talking about ancient Greece here, where the world was very different. There were cities that existed back then that no longer exist. There were cities whose names have changed. There are a lot of places that are talked about in ancient histories that you might have no idea where they were or when were the events actually taking place. There's a lot of information that, of course, is not given in the histories themselves. The historians that were writing these histories, they were writing for a contemporary audience. They didn't think anybody was going to be reading this stuff 2,500 years later. You know, go figure. So it's very helpful to have more information, which is what Robert B. Strassler decided to do. So he put together this set of books, starting with this one. But we're going to go through them by historian and not so much by the order that they originally came out, even though the landmark Thucydides was the first volume that I bought. We'll start off with Herodotus because, you know, you should start off with Herodotus, the first great Greek historian. He was pretty much inventing history as he was writing this. And I first read Herodotus, it must have been in 2007. Yeah, it was 2007 because I was in Europe. I was traveling around Europe. So I spent a lot of time on trains. And I read Herodotus on trains for the most part. And it was a remarkable experience. It was not this volume. This volume did not exist yet. I read it in just a cheap Barnes & Noble paperback edition, but it was astonishing. It's an incredible book. And The Histories by Herodotus is my favorite book of all time. It's just an incredible achievement. Herodotus, who was writing this thousands of years ago, he had no access, you know, to any kind of computers or photographs or, you know, any of the basic record-keeping stuff that we have now. You know, he was taking notes and he was traveling all around to different countries and different places to get information for his history. It's basically, this volume is the history of the Persian Wars, when the Persian Empire and Greece went to war. And the question he asks in this is why? Why did these two nations, these two civilizations, go to war with each other? And what exactly happened during this war? And who were the cultures that were involved in this? Because there were a lot of different cultures that took part in this conflict. And so it's not just a work of history. He goes very in-depth on the different cultures in Persia and all the other places, Egypt. There's a very famous section on Egypt in this book. And it's just absolutely fascinating. There were a lot of places where he got his facts wrong, but that is to be expected. It's just an incredible reading experience. And these histories, they make you really realize just how remarkable the written word is. Just what a miracle it is, really. Because we, living now, can read the words and hear the story of somebody writing this long ago in a whole different world, in a different culture. And that's just an incredible thing. And Herodotus, as an author, he's a very chatty author, and he puts a lot of himself into the book. You really get a sense of his personality in this. And it's a very modern history in some ways, in that he'll tell you different versions of events as he hears them. He'll say, you know what, this is what these guys told me. I don't believe it. Sometimes he doesn't believe what people tell him. But I'm duty-bound to tell you what they told me, even if I think it's ridiculous. Or if he thinks the story is right that he hears, he'll tell you that. But he leaves it up to you to decide how credible the different stories are that he tells you in this. And he tells a lot of stories in this volume. It's just incredible. And I did notice the first time I read Herodotus, you know, I read that Barnes & Noble edition with kind of crappy maps, and it just did not give you a lot of information. But these volumes give you a ton. And just to give you a sense, you know, these are full of illustrations. You can see all the footnotes down below. And maps. Maps are incredibly important, particularly in this volume of history. I mean, there are a ton of maps in this volume. So every few pages you have maps, because every time he mentions a place, he gives you a map telling you where this place is. And it's just enormously useful. It is an education in itself, reading the histories, having that information. You just learn so much about the ancient world from the notes and the maps. Also, I think I mentioned dates before. Very often when you are reading something like this, you know, you don't know when exactly the events he's talking about are taking place. And sometimes those dates are unknown. But if they are known, at the top of the book, it gives the date as well, when the events that he's describing take place, which is enormously helpful. He also gives you the place, basically what's going on. There's just a ton of information in these volumes. And this is Herodotus, my personal favorite. Now this volume, as my favorite book, it's a pretty hefty volume. This is the original first edition hardcover. And I've carried this around with me everywhere. I've literally taken this everywhere, so it's kind of beat up. At one point, I got a trade paperback of it just because I knew, you know, I probably was going to need a spare. This is the trade paperback version of the landmark Herodotus. And this is the one that you're probably going to find most easily nowadays, are the paperbacks. And they're actually really nice paperback editions. This is the only paperback edition I have of the landmark volumes, because I always get them as soon as they come out. But the Herodotus edition is really nice, and it's fascinating. It's a fascinating history. And yeah, just an incredible reading experience. One I go back to very often. I'm due to go back to this soon, actually. And then we've got Thucydides. Now, Thucydides was a no-nonsense historian who actually lived during the war that he's talking about, and that would be the Peloponnesian War. So this is the landmark Thucydides, A Comprehensive Guide to the Peloponnesian War. This was the first landmark edition that was made. It has an introduction by Victor Davis Hanson, but I don't hold that against it. It's an excellent book. And Thucydides was telling the story of the Peloponnesian War, which was kind of like this giant world war that happened within the Greek world. All of the Greek city-states became involved in this conflict, which basically took place between Athens and Sparta and their allies. And it was a devastating war. It was just a horrific event, which left the Greek world much weaker at the end of it than they were at the beginning. And it was long and drawn out. Most of it, or a lot of it, Thucydides tells you the story of in this book. He actually died before he could finish telling the story. But what we have of it is just incredible. Because he's very, you know, Herodotus would tell you all these stories, and he would just go into all this detail about the different cultures, and he would give you different versions of events. This is a much more focused work, and it has just such a realistic feel when you read it. It talks in a very no-nonsense fashion about the horrors of war and what becomes of nations when they engage in war, and what this can do to you on a very human level. When you hear people talk about books and you'll say, oh, everybody should read this book, I've never been the type of person who thinks that everybody should read a certain book, you know. But considering the way the world is going and how many armed conflicts we have going on right now in the world, I mean, this makes you really realize human beings have not changed. Our ability to kill each other has improved, you know. But as people, we really haven't changed that much from the time when Thucydides was writing this. And that was one of his points. People are a certain way. And people are going to fight. People are going to have wars. Wars are going to happen. Which is terribly unfortunate. And it doesn't have to be that way. But Thucydides would tell you, yeah, that's just the way we are. And so if there is one book that everybody probably should read, it's probably this one. It might be Thucydides. And this volume, of course, because of all the information that it gives you, maps, footnotes, anything that you might not easily understand from the Greek world, usually that is explained someplace in these volumes. And also, I should mention, besides just the text itself, at the end of the books, they have a ton of extra information and appendices. I mean, just on all different subjects, like the Peloponnesian League in Thucydides. This is Appendix D. I mean, you just get a ton of information in these books. So it's not just a book of Thucydides. It's a book about the work itself, because it has all this extra information that it gives you. All in one fairly large volume, but it's important stuff, and it's good to have. Unfortunately, Thucydides was not able to finish the story of the Peloponnesian War. He passed away before he could. But Xenophon, the historian Xenophon, took over, and he actually admired Thucydides and took over the history and finished it. Now, Xenophon is not at the same level of Thucydides as an historian, but still very readable history and very fascinating stuff from Xenophon. Xenophon is best known for another book, which I'll talk about in a minute, because both of them are published in the Landmark editions. But this tells you what happens in the Greek world after Thucydides leaves off. Again, it has all of the information, all of the maps, all of the stuff you would expect from the previous volumes. They're in this one. And I was really happy to get this. I think Penguin publishes this under the title A History of My Times, I think. That's their Xenophon Hellenica edition. But Hellenica is the actual title that is most often used, and that's what this volume is called, the Landmark Xenophon's Hellenica. Xenophon is best known for this. This is the Anabasis. And this tells an interesting story. I'll just read a bit from the flap there because it tells you better than I could. As Xenophon's narrative opens, the Persian prince Cyrus the Younger is marshaling an army to usurp the throne from his brother Artaxerxes, the king. When Cyrus is killed in battle, 10,000 Greek soldiers he hired find themselves stranded deep in enemy territory, surrounded by forces of a hostile Persian king. When their top generals are arrested, the Greeks have to elect new leaders, one of whom is Xenophon. A resourceful and courageous Athenian who leads by persuasion and vote. What follows is his vivid account of the Greeks' harrowing journey through extremes of territory and climate, inhabited by unfriendly tribes who often oppose their passage. This is a great book. I mean, it's just really something. And of course, the mighty Xenophon, who took part in this expedition as one of its leaders, tells the story himself, which is just fascinating. And again, full of illustrations, full of notes. This volume is packed full of all kinds of great stuff. This is a fairly popular ancient history, just because it tells just such an incredible story. But yeah, it's full of all the maps you need and everything else you need to understand what happened in the course of this story in this book. It's just great stuff. The Landmark Xenophon's Anabasis. And then we've got the Landmark Arian, The Campaigns of Alexander. And this is really important because most of what we know about Alexander the Great and his invasion of the Persian Empire, we can find in this volume. This is the history where we get a lot of our information on Alexander. Again, published by Penguin in Oxford, but this edition just offers you so much. I mean, all that stuff that you want from a Landmark edition, it's in here, including some really cool photographs telling the story of Alexander the Great and how he invades Persia. And it's just excellent stuff. Alexander the Great, fascinating individual. And unfortunately, Arian was not a contemporary. So he was going off of sources that no longer exist. He was using sources that were contemporary to Alexander the Great, but that no longer exist. They're gone. So this is the best place to get information on Alexander the Great, because he was using sources that were pretty informative that we just no longer have access to. I mean, when you think about the ancient world and all that was written during that time, so much of it was lost. So much of it is just gone now. And so we have to, you know, we have to really treasure this stuff that we do have. And this is a heck of a work, The Campaigns of Alexander. Certainly, if you're interested at all in Alexander the Great, go to this. I mean, there are a million biographies of Alexander the Great, but this is one of the books that they're using for their biographies, one of the main ones. So you should read this. And then we go to the Roman world with the last of the landmark histories with this one. This is the landmark Julius Caesar. So we have the complete works of Julius Caesar, the Gallic War, the Civil War, the Alexandrian War, the African War, and the Spanish War. Not all of these were written by Caesar, but at least the first two of them were. And it's fascinating. I mean, if you're interested in Julius Caesar, if you're interested in the fall of the Republic, I mean, you have to read this stuff. One of the most interesting periods in all of ancient history is that time when the Roman Republic fell and was replaced by the Roman Empire. And of course, Julius Caesar played the most significant role in that transition. This has all of his conquests in Gaul. It has the Civil War, where he fights against Pompey and the Roman Republic. It's fascinating. It's fascinating stuff. And this is full of all the illustrations and all the maps that you need to follow along with what's going on in this in these histories. It's just an incredible work. If you're interested in Julius Caesar at all, of course you have to read these. And this is the best place, in my opinion, to read them. Certainly if you've never read this work before, and I could say this for all of these ancient histories, if you've never read them before, this is the way to do it. Because there are going to be things that you're unfamiliar with. You're probably going to be unfamiliar with the geography and a bunch of other stuff of what Caesar is talking about in this book, all of the different people that were involved. And this gives you all the information that you need in one place. And that's really handy. Now, these books are very big. They're very big books. But they need to be. They need to be. And I can't think of a more worthwhile reading endeavor than reading the ancient historians. It's just an incredible experience that can connect you with people who lived so long ago. It's a very important part of our history, of who we are today. I mean, it's incredible stuff, and this is the best way to read these histories, are through the landmark volumes. And this was the last one, which I think came out in 2017 or 2018. Copyright 2017, so it's been a while since this came out. I've heard that we might get a landmark Polybius, which would be really nice, but I just heard that, and I've heard nothing else. It's very possible that this might be the last landmark history. I hope that's not true, but it might be. It might be. I don't know. But certainly what we have with the six books that were published, I mean, it's just, they're incredible. And I highly recommend them, and I've been talking long enough about these awesome books. I will catch you next time.